The little Cornish port of Pencastle was bright in the early April, when the sun had seemingly come to stay after a long and bitter winter. The little harbour opened from the sea between towering cliffs, and behind a lonely rock, pierced with many caves and blowholes, through which the sea in storm time sent its thunderous voice. Two men lived in cottages exactly opposite each other, both young, both good-looking, both prosperous, who had been companions and rivals from their boyhood. Abel Behenna was dark, Eric Sanson was fair. These two seemed to have singled out each other from the very beginning to work and strive together. They had now put the coping stone on their temple of unity by falling in love with the same girl, Sarah Trefusis, who was certainly the prettiest girl in Pencastle. At length, there came a time which Sarah dreaded, the time when she had to make her choice between the two men. She liked them both, and indeed either of them might have satisfied the ideas of even a more exacting girl. Sarah's mother was a person of commonplace and sordid ideas, and she was not surprised when her mother whispered to her in the little yard behind the house, "Go up the hillside for a while. I want to talk to these two. They're both red hot for ye. And now is the time to get things fixed." So Sarah went up the hillside through the narrow paths between the golden firs, and Mrs. Trefusis joined the two men in the living room of the little house. Now, neither of you has much, but if he'd put what he both have together, he'd make a comfortable home for one of ye and Sarah. Why don't he toss up for her? First, put your money together. You've each got a bit put by, I know. Let the lucky man take the lot and trade with it a bit, and then come home and marry her." With some reluctance, the two men agreed. Mrs. Trefusis's little cunning eyes twinkled. "Well, here she comes, and I leave it to her." And she went out. Sarah insisted that they should accompany her to the Flagstaff Rock, where they would be alone. And here, after a certain amount of acrimonious discussion, Abel said, "Eric, you hold the coin, and I'll cry. Now, before we settle it, let us clearly understand. The man who wins takes all the money that we both have got, brings it to Bristol, and ships on a voyage and trades with it. Then he comes back and marries Sarah." "I'll marry him on my next birthday," said Sarah. "Toss," cried Abel, and the coin spun in the air. Eric caught it and held it between his outstretched hands. "Heads," cried Abel, a pallor sweeping over his face as he spoke. Eric lifted his upper hand. The coin lay with its head up. Abel stepped forward and took Sarah in his arms. With a curse, Eric hurled the coin far into the sea. Presently, Abel looked up and caught sight of Eric's face as the last ray of sunset struck it. "It was my chance, old lad. Don't grudge it to me. I'll try to make Sarah happy, woman. You have a year. Make the most of it. And be sure you're in time to claim your wife. Be back to have your banns up in time to be married on the 11th of April. If you're not, I tell you I shall have my bands up, and you may get back too late." "What do you mean, Eric? You're mad." "No more mad than you are, Abel Behenna. You go, that's your chance. I stay, that's mine. You won by a point only. The game may change." "The game won't change," said Abel shortly. "Sarah, you'll be true to me. You won't marry till I return." "I promise for the year," said Sarah. A dark look came over Abel's face, and he was about to speak, but he mastered himself and smiled. "I mustn't be too hard or get angry tonight. Come, Eric, I won fairly. And now when I'm going away, I shall look to my old and true comrade to help me when I am gone."
"I'll help you none, so help me God."
It was God help me, said Abel simply. Then let him go on helping you. The devil is good enough for me. When he had gone, Abel hoped for some tender passage with Sarah, but the first remark she made chilled him. How lonely it all seems without Eric. Early on the next morning, Abel heard a noise at his door. A small canvas bag full of gold and silver lay on the threshold. On a small slip of paper pinned to it was written, "Take the money and go. I stay. Remember the 11th of April. Eric Sanson." That afternoon, Abel went off to Bristol, and a week later sailed on the Star of the Sea, bound for Pahang. As the year wore on, Sarah became more and more disturbed in her mind. Eric was always at hand to make love to her in his own persistent, masterful manner, and to this she did not object. Only one letter came from Abel, to say that his venture had proved successful and that he had sent some £200 to the bank at Bristol. The 11th of April was Saturday, so that in order to have the marriage on that day, it would be necessary that the banns should be called on Sunday the 22nd of March. From the beginning of that month, Eric kept perpetually on the subject of Abel's absence, and his outspoken opinion that the latter was either dead or married began to become a reality to the woman's mind. "I told Abel, and you too, that if he was not here to put up his banns in time for the 11th, I would put up mine for the 12th. He hasn't kept his word." Here Sarah struck in, out of her weakness and indecision. "He hasn't broken it yet." During the week, no news was heard of Abel, and on Saturday, Eric gave notice of the banns of marriage between himself and Sarah Trefusis. The banns were read a second time on the 29th, and Eric's hope grew more and more fixed, though there were to him moments of acute despair when he realised that the cup of happiness might be dashed from his lips at any moment, right up to the last. On the Thursday of that week, he looked in on Sarah and found her, amid a flood of sunshine, putting finishing touches to her white wedding gown. Bending over, he kissed Sarah on the mouth, and then whispered in her rosy ear, "Your wedding dress, Sarah, and for me." "Perhaps not for you. There's more than a week yet for Abel." And then cried out in dismay, for with a wild gesture and a fierce oath, Eric dashed out of the house, banging the door behind him. That night, at dusk, a wild storm came on, and the lovely Alice, a ketch trading between Bristol and Penzance, rushed to her doom on the great island rock that guarded the mouth of the port. Eric, who was among the watchers, took a rope and shouted in the ear of the harbour master,
"I shall go down on the rock over the seal cave. The tide is running up, and someone may drift in there."
"Keep back, man,"
came the answer.
"Are you mad?"
"Not a bit," came the reply. "You remember how Abel Behenna saved me there on a night like this, and how someone may drift in there again as I did."
And he was gone into the darkness. He shortly stood on the great round-topped rock over the entrance of the seal cave, where the water was fathomless. As he stood there ready, with his coil of rope poised to throw, he thought he heard below him a faint, despairing cry. He flung his rope out into the darkness where he had seen a face rising through the swirl of the foam. The rope was caught, for he felt a pull on it, and he shouted again in his mighty voice,
"Tie it round your waist, I shall pull you up."
Eric Sanson and Abel Behenna were face to face, and none knew of the meeting save themselves and God. On the instant, a wave of passion swept through Eric's heart. All his hopes were shattered. He saw in the instant of recognition the joy in Abel's face, that his was the hand to succour him. Whilst the passion was on him, he started back, and the rope ran out between his hands. Abel, encumbered with the rope that should have aided him, was plunged with a despairing cry back into the darkness of the devouring sea. Then, feeling all the madness and the doom of Cain upon him, Eric rushed back over the rocks, heedless to the danger and eager only for one thing, to be amongst other people whose living noises would shut out that last cry which seemed to ring still in his ears. When he regained the Flagstaff Rock, the men surrounded him, and through the fury of the storm he heard the harbour master say,
"We feared you were lost when we heard a cry. How white you are! Where's your rope? Was there anyone drifted in?"
"No one," he cried.
"I slept on the rock, and the rope fell into the sea."
So saying, he left them, and rushing down the steep path, gained his own cottage and locked himself within. In the morning, the storm was over, and all was smiling again. Two bodies also drifted into the harbour, one the master of the wrecked ketch, the other a strange seaman who no one knew. Sarah saw nothing of Eric till the evening. He did not come into the house, but simply put his head in through the open window.
"Well, Sarah?"
he called out in a loud voice, though to her it did not ring truly.
"Is the wedding dress done? Sunday week, mine."
"If Abel isn't there on Saturday." She saw Eric no more till Sunday afternoon, after the banns had been called the third time, when he came up to her before all the people with a proprietary air which half pleased and half annoyed her. "Not yet, mister," she said, pushing him away as the other girls giggled. At last, Sunday morning came. Eric arose early and dressed himself in his wedding clothes. He seemed as though he had grown years older in the last few days. Still, there was a wild, uneasy light of triumph in his eyes, and he kept murmuring to himself over and over again, "This is my wedding day. Abel cannot claim her now, living or dead." In the church, he sat with Sarah and her mother, holding Sarah's hand tightly as though he feared to lose her. When the service was over, they stood up together and were married in the presence of the entire congregation, for no one left the church. Both made the responses clearly, Eric's being even on the defiant side. The way from the church led down to the back of Eric's cottage, a narrow passage being between it and that of his next neighbour. When the bridal couple had passed through this, the remainder of the congregation were startled by a long, shrill scream from the bride. They rushed through the passage and found her on the bank with wild eyes, pointing to the riverbed opposite Eric Sanson's door. The falling tide had deposited there the body of Abel Behenna, stark upon the broken rocks. The rope, trailing from its waist, had been twisted by the current round the mooring post, and had held it back whilst the tide had ebbed away from it. The right elbow had fallen in a chink in the rock, leaving the hand outstretched towards Sarah, with the open palm upward, as though it were extended to receive hers, the pale, drooping fingers open to the clasp. All that happened afterwards was never quite known to Sarah Sanson. The only thing that she could remember of it all, and this she never forgot, was Eric's breathing heavily, with his face whiter than that of the dead man.
"The devil's help, devil's faith, devil's prize."